Viewer discretion is advised. There are 2 million people behind bars in America. We open the gates. Lock up.
Get off the ground! Put your hands behind your back! Put your hands behind your back! Get off the ground!
Prison is not a nice place.
He was a big-time football player at LSU. In his life, I guess it went in a different direction and ended up here.
I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy.
You act like you so high on a pedestal. You so much better than everybody.
One count of rape, 3 kidnapping.
Aggravated sex offense.
21 years for manslaughter.
Robbie is not trained to kill. He is trained to help apprehend.
I'm comfortable out on my lines. Got my horse, my guns.
Because you never know what could happen.
The judge says in her final summation, "You are nothing, Mr. Baker, but a pebble in the pond. You're nothing but poor white trash."
In rural Louisiana, halfway between New Orleans and Baton Rouge, is the second largest prison in the state, the Elaine Hunt Correctional Center. Although the facility is relatively new, it opened in 1979, the look is anything but modern. Armed officers on horseback, work crews farming the land, and no air conditioning. In the next hour, you will meet some of the men doing time, including a former NFL player and 2 aspiring boxers who win the opportunity to compete against a rival prison. A mile and a half from the banks of the Mississippi River, what appears to be a toll booth is the entrance to the Elaine Hunt Correctional Center. This all-male facility houses more than 2,100 inmates.
Every Monday and Tuesday, the reception process will start at about 5:30 in the morning. The inmates will come from your various parish prisons and other DOC facilities, and they will all pool here.
The men arriving today have been convicted of a wide range of crimes, everything from marijuana possession to murder.
I'm in for 1 count of rape, 3 kidnapping, and aggravated burglary.
We have a lot of inmates come up to us and said, "I didn't do it, they got me wrong." We're not here to judge, we're just here to make sure you serve your sentence out.
New inmates are given a white jumpsuit and lined up single file for a medical evaluation.
What we're doing this morning is we're drawing blood for sexually transmitted diseases, syphilis, gonorrhea, that type of thing.
Prison policy mandates that all incoming prisoners have their heads shaved and all facial hair removed.
But I came here in 86 and for aggravated burglary. I got 30 years. Every time you come through here, you have to have a cut procedure for your picture and ID. Even though they just did this a little under 2 years ago, but they think you changed, I guess.
As the final step in processing, inmates are given housing assignments ranging from general population to more secure units.
Open front.
Because the prison has a zero tolerance policy for rule infractions, any form of misconduct can send a prisoner to extended lockdown, where inmates spend up to 23 hours a day confined in their cells.
D1 cell block is the maximum security area of the institution. This is where we house the worst of the worst inmates. Inmates that can't abide by the rules and can't get along with other inmates within the institution.
Ryan Stinson, convicted of 9 counts of burglary and possession of stolen property, is in extended lockdown for breaking one of the prison's cardinal rules.
I'm in here for aggravated sex offense, copulation with another inmate. We was in a cell with each other and I did sexual favors for him. And one night, saw us come down and call us, locked us up.
Sexual activity in this institution is against the rules, it's forbidden. Those that do get involved with these homosexual relationships, it's very serious, and we treat it as such. And I would say that would happen maybe once, twice a month, where an officer actually has to cite somebody for doing that.
I'm homosexual. I've been homosexual all my life. It's kind of hard, I mean, because I like to wear makeup and do my eyebrows and wear certain clothes, but due to certain policies, we're not able to do this, so it puts us in an awkward position, you know what I'm saying?
Once inmates complete their time in extended lockdown, they transfer to the working cell block, a 90-day transitional housing unit where prisoners must earn the right to return to general population. One of the inmates here is 24-year-old Ahmad Lawrence, who goes by the nickname Pimp.
Well, my nickname Pimp and all, I got that from my big brother and all my cousins, by me having a lot of the ladies when I was young with the girlfriend and all. That's how I got the name, because it really didn't matter what I did and how I did it, I still kept it.
Incarcerated 4 years ago on a cocaine charge, Ahmad is doing time in the working cell block for allegedly selling drugs in prison.
Well, I was on general population, got in an incident. Somebody went and told Lieutenant Colonel that some drugs were being sold on a compound. He ended up finding me guilty and sent me to extended lockdown. And I won my appeal, and I come to the working cell block. Now I'm doing 90 days, and I'll be on the compound soon.
If and when Ahmad earns the right to return to general population, with good behavior, he could eventually be placed here in the prison's most coveted living quarters.
Basically, this is a trustee housing unit, which you see no bars. The inmates have a little bit more freedom here. They're still locked in at night. At count times, they have to sit on their bed and be counted. They do have a microwave where they can use. They do have the television where they plug in, where it's real quiet. The sound you hear now is basically what you hear any time of the day or night. What's up, Eugene Francis?
But while inmates are awarded certain freedoms for good behavior, officers and staff never underestimate how dangerous many of these men can be.
We are dealing with inmates. You know, they are here because they committed a felony.
We got it, Captain.
10-4, sir.
Coming into the institution every day, I'm always on alert. I know I'm not walking into a college campus.
I'm scared every day, you know, because this is prison. I don't take this lightly.
Mock extractions are performed routinely as training exercises. This particular drill is called a tear extraction, when an inmate is out of his cell and loose in the hallway.
We take the officer, you know, and put him in a suit to make him, he'll pose as the inmate, and we'll dictate the scenario to him. He'll pose whatever threats that we're gonna put up against the team, and the team will go in, extract him.
Father, you ready?
I'm ready.
The mock inmate's objective is to get past the officers and out the door. The team's objective is to restrain the inmate with as little injury as possible.
Controlled aggression, you can't go fast. He's on the tier, you don't have a hostage, it's just him. You take your time. Worst thing to do is get separated and an officer, it's a one-on-one with this inmate. Y'all ready?
Mm-hmm. So they're gonna stack up side by side. You're gonna have the electronic capture shield and you're gonna have conventional shields. What they're gonna do is close the space in on the inmate until he basically has nowhere else to go.
In case exercises get out of hand, officers use the code word red to stop all action.
Pamper, you all right?
I'm all right.
Okay.
Another way officers stay prepared is through arms training.
Heard the magazine.
Full-scale escape drills give tactical squads the training to prevent escapees from reaching the prison's outer perimeter.
You have a tag team and a chase team that's made up of correctional officers. We have dogs that's been trained on tracking.
Trained dogs play an important role at Elaine Hunt. This one has tracked down an officer posing as an escaped inmate.
If this has been the real deal, the dog called within 5 to 6 minutes. The subject wouldn't have got off the grounds.
Sicky. One of the newest dogs at the prison is named Canine Robbie.
Robbie, here!
Robbie is not trained to kill. He is trained to help apprehend an individual that may be either hiding in a building or is not cooperating with orders that's given to him. If the individual is still fighting, then the dog has to be physically removed because the individual is moving. The dog won't come off. I consider Canine Robbie as a partner. I feel confident that he's going to assist me because handler protection is part of what what he's certified to do.
That's a good boy. That's a good man. That's a good man.
Up next, one inmate's fall from football stardom to a life behind bars.
I lost my family. That's the biggest thing I deal with every day.
At first glance, someone might mistake this for a college football training camp. But this team is made up of inmates from the Elaine Hunt Correctional Center.
Our philosophy at Hunt is to keep the inmates busy. We feel if we keep them busy, they'll stay out of trouble. Sports help manage the inmates. It gives them something to do. It helps people to learn how to work together. And to me, good sportsmanship make a good person. We have a full-time sports director who organizes team sports such as football, basketball, soccer, baseball, and we even have a boxing team.
Among the players on the Elaine Hunt football team is the prison's most famous inmate.
My name is Ramsey James Dardar Sr. I've been here 5 years, and I'm serving a 32-year sentence for a simple burglary. I admit I did commit crime, but as far as being a bad person, I don't think I'm a bad person. I just think I allowed a drug addiction to cause me to make bad decisions, and I stole for drugs.
He's known here in South Louisiana mostly because he was a big-time football player at LSU and kind of the hometown hero.
I come from a little small town named Cecilia, Louisiana. Probably the only town you'll see a red light in Cecilia is probably around Christmas time. It's that small.
In the 1983 NFL draft, Dardar was picked by the St. Louis Cardinals and later played for the Houston Oilers.
Played with the great Warren Moon, some of the great players, Mike Rozier, guys like that. Played for the man in black, Jerry Glanville.
That's John Riggins right here. Number 44 for the Washington Redskins. This right here. Herschel Walker, 1981. I can name you a few guys, famous guys that got a few little scars on them.
Ramsey's football career ended when a neck injury forced him to retire.
From there, it was like, I guess downhill. I got convicted in 91, got out, stayed out about a year, and here I go again. Chose drugs, sociably, trying it out with the crowd, you know. Ended up hooked. I feel like I let a lot of people down. I'm just trying to do what I can do right now to try to, you know, regain some of that swagger back. You know, I'm getting kind of old, but I still have faith that one day I could, you know, get back out and maybe contribute something to society. Everybody know prison is not a nice place. Football helps me get away from the pressure of being locked up.
Hands up two times, huh?
Ramsey spends much of his free time mentoring younger inmates, both on and off the field.
They look up to him, listen to him, follow his lead in a lot of ways, especially in sports. I mean, he's like the coach and the player.
Let's go, baby, let's go. We gotta get it together. Let's get it right, baby, let's get it right.
This is Mr. Calloway, better known as Kiki the Bullet. He's an awesome athlete. And like I said, I played with some good athletes, but that's one of the best I've played with.
Pro set right, 38 sweep, tackle pull, on one. Everybody got it.
Yeah, one eye, man.
You know, Ramsey Dardar, I admire his style of play on the field and off the field. He's a perfect role model, you know. He's been to levels that I dreamed about getting, so you know, that I was deprived of going. You know, I've been incarcerated since I was at a young age, 16. You know, now 28, waiting to go home, and all I did was all my life was play sports. I'm in it for manslaughter. It was a faulty mistake, you know, but I was just young.
With less than 6 months to serve on his manslaughter charge, Kiana says prison has taught him not to judge people.
Everybody in jail are not criminals. Everybody in jail are not animals. Everybody incarcerated is not a warlock or a demon. You know, everybody have hearts. It's just wrong mistakes we made. We took the wrong turn in our life.
For Ramsey, one wrong turn cost him more than just his freedom.
I lost my family, you know, coming to prison. That's the biggest thing, you know, that's the biggest thing I deal with every day.
Well, there, it's my queen. I lost her, but I might get her back. I trust, I believe I have faith.
Coming up, officers take every precaution as inmates farm the fields.
See, when you get it like this in here, like that razor blade there,
it makes you watch your back, keeps you on your toes.
In Louisiana, farming has been a longtime tradition at correctional facilities throughout the state, including Elaine Hunt.
We have a farm here where they grow the food. That's why the food cost is so low, because we grow a lot of product that we feed the inmates here.
Every weekday morning, just after sunrise, a crew of inmates prepares for a day of grueling work in the fields adjacent to the prison. Several armed officers on horseback supervise them.
Whoa!
For security purposes, all inmates are first lined up, counted, and frisked for contraband. After the count is checked and double-checked, officers and inmates make their way to the supply depot, where inmates retrieve water jugs for the hot and humid day in the fields. They will also collect the tools they'll need.
Knowing that they have tools that they could easily use as weapons, and they've done it before, it makes you watch your back, keeps you on your toes. Because you never know what could happen. You could take one of the best guys and he decides that he doesn't like you and he wants to take you out.
When you get it like this in here, like that razor blade there, I learned that lick sharpening them knives on the floor in them cells in Angola.
Inmate Joel Baker, convicted of triple homicide, goes by the name White Trash.
The judge gave me my name. It's kind of ironic. Upon sentencing, they had me charged with 3 murders, drug deal gone bad in hotel room, shootout. They shot me, I shot them. But the judge says in her final summation after the jury delivers a verdict, it said a great injustice has been done upon society this day. Due to a conflict in the prosecution by the district attorney, you will remain in prison for the rest of your natural life. But you are nothing, Mr. Baker, but a pebble in the pond. You're nothing but poor white trash. All my life I was a bad boy. I look back and I see all the stupid mistakes that I made. And I see the young people that's here at this prison. And I hear all the stories because I listen and I think to myself, you do not know how fortunate you are. You're going out there with another chance, whether it's 5 years, 10 years, or what. You're getting another chance. I'll never get that chance. I would give my leg, my arm, for that chance. I'm never going to get it. I'm going to die right here. 13 and a half. You see that there? 13 and a half. Tell them what that is. A half-assed lawyer, 12 jurors, and a judge.
After assembling with their tools, inmates begin the long march to the field where they will spend the day harvesting vegetables and picking weeds. Each inmate earns 2 cents an hour.
We have 63 acres of vegetable gardens that we grow vegetables on, anything from squash, tomatoes, mustard greens, collard greens.
Inmates at Elaine Hunt harvest more than 1 million pounds of crops per year, all of it used at the prison.
All right, 1, Hammer, 2, Baker, 3, Sheep.
Early in the mornings, it's not so bad. We still have a little bit of coolness in the air. But as the day progresses, the humidity starts to go up, and the dew points go up, and it tends to slow a lot of them down.
The temperature can reach up to 100 degrees. Still, the 3 dozen inmates represent a formidable force. But the mounted officers keeping watch over them are prepared for any trouble.
I'm comfortable out on my lines. Got my horse, my guns. Inmates are intimidated by it.
They probably feel I'm the danger. I got nothing to lose. I mean, what you gonna do, give me some more time? I can't do what I got. I do one life sentence, if you take back one life sentence, I've still got two more. You take back the life sentences, I've still got 35. I'm more of a threat to them than they are to me.
To keep inmates from escaping, gun guards form a square perimeter around the farm detail by placing themselves at opposite corners. Inside the square, unarmed guards called line pushers supervise the inmates.
All right, the gun guard that you see out here, he has the area toward us and also the area going the opposite way. It's a 90 degree. The other gun guard in this area over here, he has a 90 degree angle the other way, which watches the two guard lines that way.
The gun line is there for inmates so they know what not to cross.
The gun line is an imaginary boundary. An inmate who gets too close to the line is verbally warned. If he continues, a warning shot is fired. If he fails to heed the warning, officers are authorized to wound the inmate to stop him.
We had it one time where an inmate took off running and we had to run them down, and we just run them down and caught them. In my career, which spans over 27 years, I've never had to use deadly force.
In addition to preventing escapes, gun guards must be prepared to protect the line pusher.
The pusher, he has to work the inmates, tell the inmates what to do. Different than the gun guards. The gun guards are just making sure they stay in their area.
Chris Melchior has worked in the field for 6 months. Recently, he changed positions from being a gun guard to becoming a line pusher.
Me as a line pusher, I don't carry a weapon. And when you go from being a gun guard carrying two weapons to line pushing and you lose that security blanket, it's not a real good feeling in your gut.
Clean the front of your rope. I want all that grass out the front.
We watch these guys, make sure they're working. It's a mind game, really. They'll test you, and you just got to keep up with them.
You know, we got five rows on that very end. Five is going to be the very end one, and then just work your way back. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Make it in their head that you're not out here playing. You're out here meaning the real thing. Basically, you've just got to put your foot down and let them know you mean business.
As their day of hard labor comes to an end, inmates load vegetables onto flatbed trucks, assemble in their lines, and begin the journey back to the prison.
It's fun to break the law and dance with the devil, but see, when you gotta pay the fiddler, it ain't nothing nice. Trust me, I'm living it. I'm living it.
Coming up, inmates try to survive a military-style boot camp.
I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy.
Many prisons in the country offer military-style reform programs called boot camp. The Elaine Hunt Correctional Center in Louisiana claims its boot camp is one of the best. The 200 inmates in the rigorous and challenging program can reduce their sentences by successfully completing the course. But you'll see, it often comes at a heavy price.
It's all right. It's all right. It's all right. It's all right. All I do is double time.
The boot camp program at Elaine Hunt is called Impact.
In my honest opinion, this is the best form of rehabilitation offered by the Department of Corrections.
For every 100 inmates who complete the program, the state of Louisiana says it saves more than $1 million. To qualify for Impact, participants must be nonviolent offenders and free of pending felony charges.
What motivated me to be in Impact was that I was trying to make a change in my life. I'm at Hunt for possession of marijuana, which is my second felony. I mean, people used to tell me on the street that I was addicted to marijuana, and I'd be like, nah, I just use it because I don't want to feel this pain or that pain. When the truth of it was is that at first it may have started out as that reason, but after so long of using it, I truly became addicted to it.
Hey, to get to the left of the front door.
After the first two possession charges I got, I never really got any help or tried to make any strive to change it. I really wanted to get over my addiction. because I know it, all it did was harm my body and harm my mind mentally.
Impact staff feel the program can help trainees like Goss overcome their dependency on drugs.
You know, these guys can't drink. They can't, you know, smoke a joint occasionally. They can't work all week and decide, I just want to pick up a six-pack of beer and drink it in my house. You know, they don't have that opportunity anymore.
Not everyone is cut out for the rigorous requirements of Impact. Participating inmates must submit themselves entirely to their superiors or be expelled.
I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy. It's not no place for anybody to be. I mean, where you gotta be told when you can eat, when you can go to the bathroom, when you gotta shower, you gotta be within arm's distance of another man at all times. So, I mean, it's just not a place that anybody would really wanna be.
We're not trying to punish you. We're not trying to enhance your penalties for coming to jail. We're trying to make it so that 5 years from now, we run into you on the street and you're just a normal, working, tax-paying citizen.
Daddy, daddy, don't you cry.
Daddy, daddy, don't you cry.
Your little boy ain't gonna die.
Along with the discipline, we try to instill that these trainees, that there's more to doing things than the role that they've chosen. They can educate themselves, they can get jobs, they can learn how to be better parents. We're giving them a sense of responsibility. You know, if you can do this the right way, it's gonna pay off. You don't have to just sell drugs, you know, to feel important.
I used to drive a Cadillac.
I used to drive a Cadillac.
Now I pack it on my back.
Now I pack it on my back.
Impact life is not my style.
Impact life is not my style.
They got me looking like Gomer Pyle.
One of the distinct features of the Impact program at Elaine Hunt is that it allows female inmates from a nearby women's correctional facility to participate alongside the men.
Louisiana Correctional Institute for Women sits about a quarter mile to a half mile down the road from us. It's easy for us to get those females here and get them back to the women's prison at night.
Bravo Company is one of the six Impact platoons. Among the inmates that make up Bravo is female trainee Teresa Warren.
22 years old, and I've been in Impact for 3 months now. My charges are access device fraud, identity fraud, computer fraud, and forgery. I was sentenced 7 years. I did a plea bargain. I asked for Impact.
Good morning, Bravo. I'm Trainee Warren, and I'm now.
Teresa is the only female in Bravo Company and was recently appointed squad leader.
Females are always struggling, and they always put us in the front. They always want us to lead. And so it's pressure on the females because we have to meet up to that standard. You know, when you're tired, you have to dig deep and say, well, you know, I'm trying to go home. I have to do this.
Can help themselves and each other.
Among the activities in Impact's regime is a conflict resolution exercise called Community Group, in which members of a platoon can openly confront each other and air their grievances.
Since you being a platoon leader, I feel like you're only looking out for yourself. You're not worried about the platoon. And I feel like being in this platoon, you can't do that.
I mean, you gotta start talking and communicating with people instead of just giving them this attitude like you don't care what's going on with them. We're a family. We gotta make it through this one way or another.
It's Teresa's turn in community group.
You act like you so high on a pedestal, like you so much better than everybody. You know, you gotta realize that. You know, you be in the class, like you the big show, you know, like you running everything. That ain't cool, you know? A lot of people feel the same way I feel, but they just might not feel like they could say it without repercussions coming back on them. I done bit my tongue too long now, and I'm speaking it out.
I never claimed to be perfect, because if I was perfect, I wouldn't be here. Every day, I have to watch everything I do because they watch me because I'm the only female. You know, I don't have a chance to go individually and talk to y'all like y'all can to each other. And I don't think I'm better than anyone else in here. If I was, I wouldn't be here. And I feel like I really do put the platoon first, that I don't try to, I purposely do not try to stick anybody out.
You know, I don't take it personal. I'm just saying how I feel. You know how I am. Mm-hmm. I speak my mind.
At first, you know, I looked at it like, man, this girl, she's a brat, you know. But as I got to know you, you know, I'm not on that one-track mind no more. I'm looking from different views, you know what I'm saying? Keep doing what you're doing, you know. You strive hard. I love you for it. Bravo, sister. I love you. Keep doing what you're doing.
She ain't big and broad as we is, but she doing what she got to do to hold us together.
Trainee Warren is actually a good trainee as far as we're concerned. We all, as a platoon, we like her.